Hello everybody and welcome to this tutorial. Today I will go ahead and download Kali Linux and demonstrate the installation procedure as well within a virtual environment. So first off, go ahead and open up your browser. Type in Kali Linux, press enter, navigate over to their website. So it's www.kali.org. It's HTTPS, don't forget to check that. Go ahead and navigate over to Downloads. Let me just go ahead and zoom in here. Excellent, so here you have images. So it says Kali Linux 64-bit. You can have a direct ISO download, download of an ISO file, or you can go over to the torrents and download it from there. Now, Kali Linux, due to the amount of tools that it has and that come pre-installed, is fairly massive for a Linux distro. I mean, it's 3 gigabytes, which is huge. Yeah, that the download of 3 gigabytes, it's not just gonna fly like that. Well, maybe it will. I don't know what sort of a connection do you have. But for the sake of this tutorial, I have downloaded it prior to this, so we don't have to go over through that procedure here of basically waiting for the download itself to happen. Or what you want to do, in case you didn't do it, you can just go ahead and click on ISO, click here Save, click OK, and the download procedure will begin. It will be displayed here in the upper right corner. So you see it reports 1 hour and 20 minutes. I'm just going to go ahead and stop that because I don't want that happening. And then you have the torrent version as well. So you just click on torrents, save file, open up what is displayed here, and it should open up transmission at some point of time. It's a bit late. Let me just go ahead and try that again. Yep, there we go. So it has a few files marked here. And just go ahead and click open, and it's gonna start the download process. This might be a bit of a faster option depending on the status of CDRs, but it's really up to you. You can't really go wrong, especially if you have a faster internet connection. It will not matter that much to you. Let me just go ahead and close the browser. Now I need to go ahead and navigate over to my start menu and pick type in VirtualBox, virtual, and as soon as you start typing, it gives you a list of options. So just go ahead and pick this one. You might want to pin it to a taskbar or something like that, like I have pinned it to my left panel. Open up VirtualBox. Excellent. So I have a few machines set up here. You can see I have like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I have 5 virtual machines set up. I can't run them all at the same time because, well, maybe I could if I reduced the amount of resources that I allot to each one of them, but I will not do that now. For the time being, I want to install a brand new Kali Linux. Before I can do that, I need to do a bit of a configuration. So first off, before the installation procedure starts or anything of a kind, I need to create a new environment in which this machine will be installed. So go ahead and click on New. Type in whatever name you wish. I'm just going to type in Kali, so I know what I'm, so I know that it's a Kali Linux because I have a lot of other virtual machines here, but you can name it whatever you want. The choice is entirely up to you. Type, it's obviously not Microsoft Windows, it's Linux, and it's not Ubuntu 64, but since it's based on Debian, I suppose I can type in Debian 64-bit here. Not sure if they have Kali, probably not. There we go, they do not have it. It doesn't matter. If you type in version Debian 64-bit, this is gonna work, no problems. Just click next, that's it. Here you will allot the amount of RAM that you wanted to have. Now, it's not RAM intensive, it should work fine as it is by default, but I just have a habit of allotting it above 1 gigabyte. For the sake of this tutorial, I will allot it 2, 2 GB of RAM, primarily because we will be working with some of the programs that can be demanding and that can be resource intensive. So I want to do this, but don't worry about it if you've given it too much RAM or too little RAM. You can always change this later on. This is very flexible. That's the beauty of VirtualBox. That's why I like it so much. You can change these at any point of time if you've deemed that you need the resources elsewhere or that you have more resources that you can allot here. So just click next. Just go ahead and click create. Create a virtual hard drive now. That is the drive that this machine will be using. And just use this one, VDI VirtualBox disk image. That's the hard drive file type. Click next. Dynamically allocated. That's very important. And you can read here what dynamically allocated means. Basically, it is hard drive file will only use space on your physical hard drive as it fills up to the maximum fixed size. And click next. Here you will allot the drive space. Now I have a lot of drive space, so I'm just gonna go ahead and allot like maybe 120 gigs. That's gonna be more than enough for this undertaking. Since I do have a lot of drive space on my laptop, I don't really care, but if you don't have enough drive space or something like that, you can go ahead and allot it 50 gigabytes or something like that. Should work fine, no problem. 120 is more than I need, way more. So just go ahead and click create. That's it. Now we have our Kali, now we have our environment under the name Kali set up. There is just one more thing that we need to do. We need to configure the boot order for this machine, and maybe not the boot order, but rather instead the location of the ISO file which it will pull. So go ahead and right click on it, settings, display storage, click on storage, click on empty. There's this disk icon here. It's when you click on it, it says choose a virtual CD disk file. So I have a few here, but none of these are what I actually need. If you have something in your CD-ROM drive, you can just go ahead and click here and it's gonna pull an image from a CD. But that's not really the case here. We have an ISO file that we want to use, so just go ahead and open it up, click on home, and I have it in my downloads folder. It should be around here somewhere. Yep, there we go. Kali Linux 109A AMD64. I do believe that I'm slightly behind the latest version, but we're gonna fix that with updates, no problems. Open it up. It says Kali Linux 109A AMD64.iso, and that is the type of file that we're looking for, .iso. Open it up. There you go. It's now inserted. You can see it here, the blue markation in the center. It's marked, and Kali Linux is in the tray. So click OK. Double click on Kali and it says starting. Now it's running. You have a few options here to utilize. You can have live AMD64, live forensic mode, USB persistence, live USB encrypted persistence, or just go ahead and install it. So what these options are, you have live, which is basically when it runs from a USB stick or something like that. Those are just live boots, can be USBs, CDs, or something of a kind where the system is booted from an external device, and that is what people usually do when they want to access certain services which are protected by the current operating system. So when you bring it down and when you plug in your USB and boot the system from the USB stick, your system, it will not recognize any of the file permissions previously set by the system that was installed there on the hard drive of the machine because it is down. And then you can, I don't know, then you can delete stuff that the system would not allow you to delete. This is one of the way that people have used to actually delete Internet Explorer in Windows. More as a joke than anything else, just to prove that it's possible. And this is also one of the ways in which you can pool the password files in Windows and decrypt them as well. So we will deal with that a bit later on when we get into more advanced stuff. But you have failsafe mode, live failsafe mode. Well, every system pretty much has a failsafe mode. Today, it's basic boot, and it tries to just load the basic things, and this is practically guaranteed to boot every time you boot into failsafe mode, unless you've messed something up that is in a very, 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 very serious way. Failsafe mode will boot almost always. Forensic mode for investigators and such people, we're not going to be dealing with it in this fashion, because we don't want the live, we want the installed version. And then you have live USB persistence. So this is a very nice feature that you can have. For example, you can have an operating system, Kali Linux or many other distros, installed on a USB stick, and you can have a rather large USB stick, like, I don't know, 256 gigs or something of a kind. It doesn't need to be that big, it can be a lot smaller, but the bigger the better, primarily because of this persistence flag. You can work, and all of your work will be saved on that USB hard drive, so you can make permanent changes to a live CD. Well, generally not to a CD, this is a USB. I do believe that there is a way of doing this with a CD as well, but nobody does that anymore. Just have a USB stick and you'll be fine. You see the first version, the live one, it means when you take it out, when you shut it down, it will forget any and all changes made to it. But when you have live USB with persistence, you can have those changes remembered. You can write them down, so next time you boot it, they will load. And here you have another great option. It's live USB encrypted persistence. So what this means is basically that your old information contained on your live USB will be encrypted, and if you happen to lose it, nobody will be able to access your data, so provided of course that you have something sensitive there worth protecting. And of course, I mean, you would still lose the data, but you would ensure that no one can actually access it or anything of a kind. So if you lose it, if you have some passwords or something like that stored there, oh well, no big deal. You know, it's encrypted. Nobody's going to be able to break it, provided, of course, that you have a long enough encryption key. In any case, in the follow-up tutorial, I will go ahead and proceed with the installation. Notice that we will need to install a few more things, because look at this, I'm resizing the screen now, and once I go past a certain size, I can no longer increase the size of my screen, of my virtual screen. Rather, instead, I'm just increasing its edges. And that is because we need something called guest additions for VirtualBox. Guest additions enable full screen displays of virtual machines. But more of that to come in the next tutorial, and I hope I'll see you all there.